So acne scarring is more likely to develop if you pick at or squeeze your acne instead of treating it or allowing it to heal. And some types of acne are more likely than others to leave scars. That's why how you treat your skin during a flare-up and how you protect your skin can make all the difference. Some people don't scar while others scar badly. So in this video, we will break down all the different types of acne scars and look at as many ways to treat each type, so you definitely want to stay tuned till the end. Also, real quick guys, before we get started, it would mean the world to me if you hit the like button down below for the YouTube algorithm and turn the bell on next to it to stay up to date with new weekly videos. You see, whiteheads and blackheads are typical and tend to heal smoothly and usually don't cause scarring. Then there are the types that can lead to scarring: pustules, papules, cysts, and nodules. This is because these are seen as a lot more inflammatory. So when they do scar, they'll scar in two basic ways depending on whether there is a net loss or a net gain of collagen. A net loss of collagen would be your atrophic scars, which will be your ice pick, boxcar scars, and rolling scars that are known as pitted scars. And if you have a net gain of collagen, then you have what's known as hypertrophic scars, which includes your keloid scars, which we'll get into as well, since they do behave a little differently. 80 to 90% of people with acne scars have scars associated with a loss of collagen, which will be your atrophic scars types. So it's best we start there, with the first atrophic scar type being ice pick scars. Now, ice pick scars are the most common of the three atrophic scars, more common than boxcar and rolling scars. They are narrow, deeper than they are wide, and if you look carefully, they look V-shaped, and you'll usually find them on your forehead and upper cheeks where your skin is thinner. And there are about three ways to solve them. Punch excision, the scar is cut out using a small cookie cutter like punch tool and then stitched back together. Punch grafting, where the scar is cut out and the hole is filled with a graft of skin from behind your ear. Or getting the TCA cross, chemical peel, which causes the body to create new skin. And here's a real before and after from scientific literature, so you can see that it clearly works. The second type of atrophic scar is the next most common type, which is the boxcar scar. This one is wider in size, it's round with distinct sharp edges, but is a lot more shallow than an ice pick scar and more common on the forehead, lower cheeks, and jaw. And there are four methods to solve these ones. You can go with the punch excision, which we mentioned, dermabrasion, which exfoliates the top layer and produces new collagen, dermal filler, which fills the area with filler to help raise the skin, or laser therapy, which stimulates new tissue. And lastly, the third type of atrophic scar, which is your rolling scars. These ones make your skin look uneven and wavy because they have sloping edges and are really wide. Sometimes they're so wide that you could actually stretch them out and they look smooth. But they are unique because they have these fibrous bands that are actually pulling on the skin downward. One way to treat them is by actually cutting these with a technique called subcision, which involves a tiny needle that is wiggled back and forth to cut the bands and cause the skin to lift back up. Microneedling seems to help them out too, since they are pretty shallow and not deep. I actually made a video on microneedling versus lasers, which you should definitely check out as well. So that wraps up the atrophic scar types. Now let's look at hypertrophic scars. Remember, these are the scars where you gain an excess of collagen and at the same time have less collagenase activity too, which are the enzymes that break down collagen. You'll have less of those. And hypertrophic scars are the same size as the acne that caused them. But with keloid scars, they create a scar larger than the acne site and grow beyond the area. And keloid scars are more common in people with a darker skin color. But now let's look at hypertrophic scars and what they look like. These ones are typically pink, raised, and firm, and sometimes can be even tender and itchy. Keloid scars look like this, and the skin continues to produce collagen even though there's no need for it to, and are often discolored, and chances are you'll get them if you have family members that have them too, since there is a genetic component behind keloid scars. And the good news is that you can treat these with cortisone shots followed by laser. After the cortisone shot, you can also try retinoids like your over-the-counter retinol and tretinoin to improve the appearance even more. And if that doesn't work, you could also get them surgically removed, which doesn't always work because They can grow back and it can actually be really frustrating when they do. Getting the best results often requires repeat visits with your dermatologist. In the literature though, I wanted to point out something. We have strong evidence that when it comes to hypertrophic scars, silicone-based products represent one of the most common and effective solutions in preventing and also in the treatment of hypertrophic acne scars for five reasons. One, the increase in hydration. Two, the increase in temperature. Three, the protection of the scar. Four, the increased tension of O2. And five, the action on the immune system. And the current one that I use actually for myself and have been using is the one by BioCorneum Advanced Scar Treatment, which has a patented cross-linked silicone gel technology, which you can pick up down below in the description. It also has an SPF 30 in it too, which is amazing since it also will protect from discoloration from the sun. On the other hand, if you've ever tried to treat atrophic scars with home serums and creams, you might already know that just how hard they are to get rid of. There are plenty of over-the-counter products like gels, oils, and serums that keep making these attractive claims about getting rid of the acne scars, like those left behind from cystic acne, for example. What these products actually help with are the acne marks that leave off after the acne has cleared, as well as improving the texture of the skin. What they target is post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation that often occurs after acne, which we've already discussed in this video here, which I highly encourage you to watch after this one. Atrophic and hypertrophic scars are more severe and thick. The treatment has to be targeted towards remodeling the skin or stimulating collagen production at the specific amounts to smoothen out the skin. In other words, the effectiveness of those over-the-counter products that you hear of have to be proportional to the severity of the scarring and the depth of the scarring. The closest thing you have to do this at the time of recording is Adapalene 0.1%, like the one by Differin, which I've already talked about as well on this channel, which unfortunately the 0.3% isn't available over the counter since that's the percentage that actually shows some promise. And the 1% retinol, like the one by Paula's Choice, since it works on bumpy texture, which can technically minimize the appearance of the scar. So those two will be your best bets when it comes to over-the-counter products, and they can be found in the description below. In the end, your own DNA will play a role in your scars too. Your genes determine how well your skin heals, the amount of collagen produced, and the depth and severity of the scar recovery. But I'm more curious to hear from you guys though. What are your thoughts on acne scar treatment? Leave them down below. In the meantime, check out my other videos on scars by clicking this video here. And also, subscribe if you found this video useful. And I'll see you guys on the next one.